Okay. Good morning. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the fifth meeting of the 2023 meeting of this Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. The convener, Joe Fitzpatrick, is unable to attend today, so I will convene in his absence. Kokab Stewart is attending as committee substitute, and I'd like to welcome Kokab to the meeting this morning. Our first item on our agenda is declarations of interest, and as such, our first agenda item is to ask Kokab if she has anything to declare, any relevant interests.
I do not.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Second item is to agree to take item 5, which is consideration of today's evidence sessions in private. Are we all agreed? The third item on our agenda today is to hear virtually from the convener and deputy convener of the Scottish Youth Parliament's Equalities and Human Rights Committee, providing an update on areas previously discussed with the committee. And I'd like to welcome to the meeting this morning Rumiza Ahmed, MSYP, and Zainab Adeleye, MSYP convener and deputy convener, respectively, of the Equalities and Human Rights Committee of the Scottish Youth Parliament. You're both very welcome this morning. Members will recall Rumiza and Zainab from our business planning day in September, and we are keen to hear from both of you about what you have to say. Either of you can respond to any of the questions we might ask, but if there's something one of you is really keen to say, please just put an R in the chat and I will come to you when we can. I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and I would now invite Rumiza and Zainab to make some opening remarks. Over to you. Rumiza first, and then Zainab.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Rumiza Ahmed, MSYP for Kirkcaldy and the convener of the Equalities and Human Rights Committee. And I think everyone from last time, you all were really sweet and just generally really kind. And I heard before the meeting that everyone was planning on meeting someone again. So I brought him along on the call today. So good morning, everyone. Here's our committee mascot again, Fernando. I just thought I'd bring him back because I heard a lot of talk of, is Fernando coming, is Fernando not coming? So yeah, I brought Fernando and I'm going to hand it over to Zainab just to give her an introduction.
Hello everyone, my name is Zainab Adeleye. I am the MSYP for Glasgow Southside and I'm the deputy convener for the Equalities and Human Rights SYP. And I just wanted to say thank you so much for agreeing to meet us again. And we are really excited to share with you the progresses we've made from the last time we've met. So thank you.
Thank you very much both. And thank you for being here and for agreeing to have this conversation with us. We'll now move to questions, and I'll ask Rachel if you want to kick off first.
Morning, and nice to see you again. I just wanted to ask, first of all, it's a very broad question, but I just wondered what the MSYPs had been doing to increase the awareness of culture and heritage in the roles that you have undertaken.
So, Rumiza, do you want to take that one first?
Yeah, I'll take that first. So we met in October, we had a SYP sitting, and our committee met up and we had discussed how we wanted to take it further in inviting MSYPs to discuss their heritage. So we consulted MSYPs in online, because obviously at that point we were still planning things out when we had all met in person. So we had feedback and we had a few MSYPs who came forward to discuss their heritage, and we're just taking that forward to try and see if we can get any more MSYPs or former MSYPs and just continue to start a discussion a little bit more. Some people aren't 100% knowing of their background as much, so they're researching into it, whereas others don't feel as comfortable. So it's kind of difficult to ensure that we get as much as we can, but also respect people in the sense of, are they okay with sharing things and stuff like that. So we're a bit half and half with it.
That forward in terms of either policy or motions?
Yes, so we did put our committee motion forward in the October sitting, like we'd previously mentioned. I can read it out for you if you'd like, if I can just find it. Sorry, 2 seconds. So our committee motion was the Scottish Youth Parliament believes that decision makers take further steps to ensure students who do not speak English as a primary language have the right to education upheld and ensure that their quality of English for speakers of another language classes made available in every school and college across Scotland, as well as increased training for educators to better help these students. Our motion did pass with 94% agreement from the membership, and we had not made it only an opinion motion, an action motion, and we have 5 action points that we're working on from it, and we're on action 1 currently.
Okay, I've got another question as a follow-up to that. We've seen a lot of children arriving to Scotland from Ukraine, and I just wondered if you'd had any contact with these children who have obviously got no or little understanding of the English language, and you know, have you had contact with young people?
Recently, I've not been able to do as much national work with people. However, locally, I have spoken to a few young people. We've had a lot of Ukrainian refugees as well in my constituency, especially not just recorded, but in Fife. So I have spoken to young people, and then on top of that, I've been trying to do more of speaking to services and understanding how big of an issue it is, so that we can do more consultation and actually see how we can get help as soon as possible for these students and young people.
Okay, I'll bring Zainab in, and nice to see you again. Is there anything you want to add on the engagement that you've been doing as MYSPs with young people, particularly regarding their culture and their heritage? And also on the question I asked about young people coming from Ukraine, how do you think that they have been able to participate, particularly in learning the English language?
Regarding the first question on how we've managed to include culture and heritage, we last time when we met, we spoke about holding an event for Black History Month, which we successfully done. So we got members of our community to come together and talk about Black people who inspired them. And the thing for that was healthcare. So for example, I spoke about the popular meme that was popular, I think in 2020, about a lady who had Gorilla Glue on her hair, etc. And a lot is known about her, but not a lot is known about the doctor that actually helped her, because she had gone through a lot of, you know, healthcare procedures and none of them worked. But because he had like a chemical degree, etc., he had gone through all that and, you know, managed to help her. So that was just kind of a way to just bring awareness to, like, Black people whose works are not really out there. Regarding the Ukrainian refugees who are just coming in, we have not had any contact with them, but one thing I believe is because we have connections with the Scottish Refugee Council, so I think if we maybe contact them, we might be able to hear how they help them, because I know the Scottish Refugee Council often holds meetings and workshops for newly incoming refugees. So if we contact them, then we would hear about how they're, you know, managing to move around.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Rachel. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Thank you for joining us and for bringing Fernando with you as well. It's always nice to see a pet stuffed or otherwise online. I'm really keen to pick up on kind of where my colleague Rachel Hamilton's left off, which is around the cultural awareness. So I know that when we last spoke, there was an aspiration for us to do something around particular weeks. And I just wondered, is this something that we can help with on an ongoing basis? What would you like, or do you need politicians here in this room, but also across the chamber to do to support that work?
Zainab, do you want to come in on this first and then we'll go to Rumiza, or the other way around? Which do you have?
I'll let Zainab go first.
Okay.
I think Rumiza will argue with me here. If we have like culture, you know, heritage coming into speak, if we kind of have like a merged event, I think that will have more more, it would be broadcasted more. I feel like that would just bring more awareness, more people to see what we're doing. So kind of having like a merged event and people even from the parliament speaking at those events.
Sorry, Zainab, I missed the very last bit there. I think you said having MSP speaking at various events throughout the year.
Yeah, at the events, yeah.
Okay, thanks.
And Rumiza, do you want to add to that?
Yes, I'm just going to slightly base off Zainab there. I planned a little bit of extra notes just in case, so I'd make sure that I knew exactly what I was saying. So for me, it would be that last year we weren't able to do as much for Asian Heritage Month, particularly South Asian Heritage Month, as we were kind of coming out of summer and we were struggling to kind of get basis of what we could cover. So this year, we are really hoping that either SYP and Scottish Parliament can try and kind of work together and just raising more awareness, whether it's just through social media campaigns, getting MSPs to talk about their heritage, as well as MSYPs, like how we're planning on doing it, and making it a longer planning it longer, making sure it's thorough, and that we can actually go in depth about it and work together on it, so that it shows that not only we're just talking about heritage, but it's also the young people and Scottish Parliament involved. It shows that we're working together to understand people from Asian backgrounds as well.
Thank you. That's really helpful. We can have a think about how we can do that. Is it okay, convener, to go on to my question about ESOL?
Yes, of course.
Thank you. Obviously, this week, where the focus has been a lot on Ukraine and the illegal war there. And we've already heard very briefly about that just now. Can you tell us a bit about whether or not those families, and I take the point about your engagement with them. Do you know if access to English as a second language training here has been stretched, and are there enough resources to make sure that people who are coming here from Ukraine and other countries are getting access to this education as well? Or maybe start with Rumiza, please.
Personally, over the last little while, I would say that there has been a little bit of a stretch and more accommodation for Ukrainian citizens, Ukrainian refugees. However, I feel like we could be doing a bit more about it and actually seeing how we can expand more. I know it's easy for me to just say that, but there could be a bit more done to help those students who are coming here. It's enough of a struggle as it is just moving. And sometimes I have seen recently there is support, but there's not enough support. It's kind of, they're kind of still getting that, having to do it independently on their own. And it's kind of, after everything that they have been through, they shouldn't have to all have this independency when it comes to their learning completely and utterly. So I feel like a bit more should be done.
Can I just ask a wee bit more about that? When you say independently, do you mean families themselves are having to go and source this training as opposed to it being readily available?
Not in that sense, more when young people are in educational services, whether it's colleges, schools, sometimes there's not enough being put through from staff to actually support them. There are the services, but it's mainly staff, or there's sometimes the services aren't able to be available as often for students' needs.
Thank you. No, I appreciate that. Zainab, do you have anything further to add?
Regarding the scope and how this training has been, you know, stretched, I don't really know. But one thing I noticed was that the young people, the young Ukrainian refugees will have access to this in schools. But then for the ones who are maybe adult or like over the age of 17, this training is not readily available. They have to go and source it. I was speaking to a refugee, she's not from Ukraine. However, she's speaking about how when she just come in, she had to go and source this ESOL training. And when she even had to source it, the application process was rigorous, it was long, and she complained about her English not being good, and then her having to do this long thing with so much English written, it was so hard for her to apply, and she just gave up till she went to an organization that helped her. So I feel like these like application processes do ESOL trainings for maybe adults or even young people who are older than the school age should be made easy, or even they should work with like charities in which these refugees would go to help them, you know, apply to it and etc.
Thank you. And my final question for this panel this morning is, in the motion that you read out earlier on, you say that further steps are needed. Could you set out some of those further steps for us?
You mean in the action plan that we kind of came up with for afterwards, once we had passed the motion?
Yes.
Yeah. You just give me 2 seconds, sorry, I've just written out for you. So our first action that we're currently working on is to talk to relevant stakeholders involved in this work, so Education Scotland, Scottish Refugee Council. So getting in touch recently, we've had a bit of an issue with just, I've had to do with university, then I've been busy, or just because schools are back on, we've had a bit of a struggle with contacting. But locally, I have spoken to SYP staff. I've got a little bit of local kind of work that I'm going to be working on and doing some viewing of how the 5 services are, and then hopefully we're going to expand it from within the committee, get other people within the committee to kind of see how things are as well in all meets to make a toolkit highlighting what key aspects should be included in order to make it for staff. The third action is social media campaigns to emphasise the importance of mandatory training. And the fourth point was to speak to decision makers and try and get a commitment on ensuring that this motion will get taken forward. And the fifth point was to work with UNITE when possible for further stages of our campaign.
Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. I'll move to Pam Gosell.
Thank you, Chair. And good morning, Ramiza and Zainab. And it's always good to see Fernando again. My question is around the ESOL support motion. It had overwhelming support from the Scottish Youth Parliament, with around 94% of the members agreeing to the motion. And the motion stated that the classes should be made available in every school and college across Scotland. My question really I wanted to ask you is, do you think that there should be geographical differences in the rollout of ESOL support, for example, between rural and urban areas? Ramiza, you want to ask? Yeah, and I'll go to Zainab, yeah.
I'll answer first, sorry. Could you repeat that question if that's okay? Sorry, my microphone's been a bit iffy.
Yeah, of course, yeah. What I asked was, there was overwhelming support, obviously, from the Scottish Youth Parliament on the ESOL support motion. 94% members agreed to the motion. And the motion itself was around classes being available for every school and college across Scotland. So I wanted to ask you, do you think there should be geographical differences between urban and rural areas on the rollout of ESOL support? Do you think all of Scotland should get the same? Sorry, probably all of Scotland should be getting the same support, ESOL, or should there be geographical differences where it's needed?
Well, there's 2 parts of this conversation that it can lead to. It could be that there's 2 arguments that could be made. It depends on obviously areas where there are more young people who need the support. Sometimes it can be that urban areas have more people who need support, whereas rural areas doesn't. However, from consultation, it has been found that rural areas are getting near to nothing support. So at least if we can, it would be nice to make sure that it is 100% equal. However, we do need to make sure that depending on the area and how many people do need the support, that we base it off of that and ensure that everyone is getting some form of good support within their areas, and it's not that we're trying to cover everything equally, and it's not impossible, but we struggle to do it necessarily, if that makes sense.
Yeah, no, thank you. Zainab?
Based on what Ramisa said, yes, we should make the useful support available to people who need it more, because we kind of believe that it's equality through equity. So it's kind of in a scenario where A needs water, but you give A food instead of water. Even though you're thinking you're doing a good thing, you're not giving them what they actually need. So giving the people who actually need that, you know, the ESO support, and then later on the people who maybe the small proportion of people in the urban areas who need it, then so it's best to give maybe urban areas, for example, if they have like people who need ESO support, you give them the less support, and then the rural people who need more, you give them more, so we have a lot of resources. Because I think we're working on minimal resources right now, so it's best to just use it wisely so we have excess.
Thank you. Chair, I've got a follow-on question. Is that okay? Yeah. Thank you for that response. The motion speaks a lot about the ESO support being available in schools and colleges, and not a lot of mention of community learning. And if you remember the last time you were on, I was speaking about that maybe we should be looking at those places of worship, because I certainly know that mosques, gurdwaras and temples and many other places of worship do a lot with education, especially Sunday school, and it could be with learning the, you know, language Punjabi. But do you think we should be reaching out to them to be helping deliver ESOL support as well? And do you think that should be considered so that we can reach out to those communities? Zainab, do you want to go first, or Ramza, I'll leave it to you.
I think yes, because it's more often than not, when people just come into the country, they kind of just look for people they can really connect to. And most of the times it's places of worship. So if they are more than likely to go to places of worship, then it's really smart to just like work with them, you know, because that is where they're readily available going to.
Ramiza, yeah?
I do think it will include people who go to places of worship. Sometimes people don't really fully know their options. I've actually helped a few friends or people out who do struggle with the English, and they can't really necessarily go to their educational services and speak to them about it. They're quite anxious or just generally are unable to do so. So definitely go when you're at a place of worship where even people speaking the same language that your first language is from, having that comfort of being able to then say, look, I do need support with my English or any other language, it's really important that we can also offer that as well.
Thank you for your response. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Pam. Kokab, to you now.
Thank you very much. I was interested in, you said about decision makers and they had to take action. So I think you've already responded to my colleague Pam with some of the actions that the Scottish Government could take. But I was wanting to widen that out a little bit and ask about the areas that you're prioritising and how they fit with the priorities of the Scottish Government, and an opinion on whether you think that that is a good fit, or are there areas that the Scottish Government should be looking at that would align with your priorities? And Ramiza first, please, if that's possible.
Is it okay if I get just, if you could say it again, sorry, it's just my internet is being really a big pain today.
No problem at all. I'll try and I'll break it down. So one bit was just about your priorities, the things that you were looking at and how they fit with the Scottish Government's priorities, and whether you think, is that a good fit, or do you think that the Scottish Government could be doing things differently?
Is this just in general or just related to our committee motion within the ESO?
It's regarding your committee motion, yeah.
Okay. Sorry, just give me 2 seconds. I'm trying to think of the best way to answer this.
I don't mind if Zainab wants to come in.
Zainab, would you like to come in and I'll think of a proper answer? I've got things in my head, I'm just trying to say it properly.
It's fine, take your time.
I think regarding refreshing the plan, like to maybe stretch out ESOL, I think that the new ESOL strategy hasn't been refreshed since 2020, and you know, things have changed since then. So I think if maybe the plans regarding how much ESOL is led and outreach could be refreshed, I think that kind of like allows people for kind of trying to do.
So the policy on the plans on ESOL haven't been refreshed since 2020, did you say? I couldn't hear.
Yeah. 2020,
sorry.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Thank you. Thanks so much. Ramiza, are you all right there?
Yeah, no, sorry. I was just going to bounce off what Zainab said again. It would be great to see a refresh after, especially the last going on 3 years that we've had recently, understanding kind of where we're at now so that we can see where we're going to move on next. And especially as it doesn't seem like a huge priority on the Scottish Government's priority list, it would be really good if that could get seen to and that we could see more focus on it.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, CoCab. I'll move on now to Karen, please.
Hi, good morning. Hope you can hear me okay.
Yep, we can, Karen.
It's nice to see you both again, and it's nice to see Fernando too. It's a joy. I want to ask you a question really in regards to contested heritage. I'm just really curious and really want to get your viewpoints. For example, if we're looking across at towns, villages, cities throughout Scotland, there are statues that perhaps have a negative past to them. If we look at Henry Dundas, for example, in Edinburgh, his statue's been recontextualised in the form of a plaque because he was for delaying the abolition of slavery. And I would just like to know, what are your views on that? And what do you think we as elective representatives can do to take perhaps action on these things and to call out these things? I'll go to Zainab first, sorry. Jeez.
The Scottish Parliament, Youth Parliament, I mean, we have a policy which calls for the removal of all statues, plaques and street signs that commemorate those who were complicit in and benefited from slave trade. And we understand that it's a bit controversial because of the significance of history in our day-to-day life, but we do support like the removal of the statues because statues are kind of a thing of honor, and you know, holding these statues, you know, still being upright, kind of like, oh, are we honoring these behaviors these people have shown? So I think it just comes down to us, what are we putting the statues up there for? Are they still there for honor, or do we now see the, you know, the bad things these people have done, and do we still believe they deserve to be there?
That's really helpful. Thank you. Ramiza, do you want to come in?
I was just going to say about Zainab, and just going back to the policy that we as Scottish Youth Parliament do have, and on top of that, it is that, yes, these people have made important, significant changes. However, we can't outweigh the good with the bad as well. It is good to commemorate what they did. However, we do have to discuss the. I'm trying to word this in a good way, but also just commemorate the good, but also discuss the controversy that they've had in the past and the things that they have done in the past. Because one thing that's been been noticed over time is when there is a lack of discussion on the more uneasier, controversial aspect of things, that can often, for young people or just generally the population, we do feel as though then we're not getting the whole truth, or that we're not understanding these people correctly. So if it was that the facts were stated of these are the things that these people have done, it's amazing, it's great. But then also these are the things that they've also done on top of it. But like Zainab had also said, we have got the policy and that's what we believe in. But if that made sense, I know it's a bit half and half of it.
No, it does make sense. I'm really grateful for your contributions there, because you know, we really need to know and understand, is recontextualising enough? As Zainab, you pointed out, you feel that statues are actually erected in honour of somebody and not just a reflection of history in a moment in time. So even if we're looking back on these things, looking forward in how we give honour and how we show history is really important as well, so we don't, you know, repeat mistakes going forward. So really interesting to hear your views on that. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much, Karen. And Fulton.
Hello.
Hello there.
For some reason my video's not coming on. That's it. Thank you. Thanks, Convener, and thanks very much to the panel. Can I just say that I've really enjoyed this session, and thank you very much to both of you for what you've already put forward. The area I was going to cover is about how you engage with young people, and I know that you actually talked a lot about that earlier when answering questions from my colleague Rachel Hamilton, so I won't go totally over that. But what I did want to know is there any particular areas or schools where it's more difficult to get that engagement, or is it pretty much across the board that if you're contacting local authorities or schools that the MSYPs are getting, you know, access, if you like, to other young people? Is there any difficulties you're encountering? And if so, is there anything that we can do as a Scottish Parliamentary Committee to help you with that? I'm happy with any MD to answer it. Sorry.
Rumiza, do you want to come in on that first?
Yes, so I think definitely when it comes to trying to consult young people or just generally having a conversation, there are many times where people are quite open and wanting to hear more, or just wanting to listen to, want us to listen to them. So whether it's schools, educational services, organisations are a big one. Youth organisations, they are very keen. They're more keen than I would say sometimes schools or other educational institutions that actually really want to get to know us a bit more, and they want us to kind of hear what they have to say. And like Pam had mentioned earlier, places of worship are often places where people really go to, and sometimes I find it easier actually going there and consulting young people. And it's a great way, even for Scottish Parliament, generally MSPs, it's a great way of consulting people. If you can't actually consult them otherwise, you'll always find people there. They'll always want to be heard or have a discussion, and it's a civil discussion as well that you will have. It's a calm, peaceful discussion. There's people from all ages that are there as well, which is great. However, sometimes I do feel like being an MSYP, sometimes people don't actually understand who we are or what we represent or the work that we do, so we can kind of get disregarded or put to the side. And it can be a bit difficult at times actually speaking to people, but it would be great to have a bit more awareness on like who we are and what we represent, so that people actually know more, young people know more who to go to.
Thanks, Rumiza. And Zainab, do you want to come in on this?
Yeah, so my personal experience with going to schools, etc., has not been good, mostly because the people don't really know who we are. So, for example, last year in, like, I think it was in September, me and a couple of other MSYP in my constituency have decided to go into schools for a consultation. And what we got met with at the front desk was, what is that? What is SYP? What is that? Because we're not really put out there, and they don't really understand the importance of like students having their voice heard through us. So we're kind of just like a secondary issue. We're not being seen as the main way in which students' voices can be heard. So in regards to the question in which and how the Scottish Parliament or government could help us, you know, going forward is, I don't know, like maybe implementing our importance in regards to young people. Or just like, I don't know the word, just like making sure they know that, okay, the Scottish Parliament is really important because of young people, because we are elected for the, you know, the voice of young people. So I feel like if our importance is kind of implemented then we'll kind of get different results.
So do you think you'll know that part of our job as MSPs is going out to schools in our constituencies and regions and speaking to the classes? Do you think it would be helpful for MSPs as a matter of course when they're out speaking to modern studies classes or whatever it is that we get asked to go out and speak to primary schools, making sure that part of our presentation is about making schools and classes aware of the Scottish Youth Parliament, and even doing some joint up sessions with our local MSYPs? Do you think that would be helpful in the round?
Yeah, that would be really helpful, because that kind of shows that, okay, these are your representatives. These are your representatives. These are the people you could easily come to, because they have easy access to us, but they kind of don't know, many people don't know about our work slash existence. So if that is part of the presentation, I feel like that will give us better outreach. And in regards to the events where with like modern studies, et cetera, it would be really good if MSPs could invite your local SYPs to come with them to these events, if that is possible. That, oh yeah, this is your local MSYP, this is their email, this is that and that and that.
Thanks, Zainab. Fulton, anything else? I think Ramiza wants to come back in on this. Ramiza, do you want to?
Happy for Ramiza to come back in. I've got no other questions after that, Maggie. Thank you.
Okay, thanks,
Fulton. Yeah, no. Fulton, that was really a great point that you'd made about how we can do that. And I would agree with Zainab. Actually taking MSYPs to these events would be really great. And it's good to, as soon as like MSYPs are elected, like I know a lot of MSPs have done it, get to know them a bit, but also just kind of keep them updated on how things are and what you do, and inviting them to things and working together with them a bit more, but not just generally, but showing people that we're doing that as well. I know whenever we were at school, we'd always get taught like this is what an MSP does, and then when people would come in, we would actually get to hear it from themselves, but also having half of what an MSP does, but what an MSYP does, the similarities between both and the differences, it would be really great, because I never knew that until I joined SYP, and my SYP experience has been a bit, it's been great, but actually knowing before what SYP was, what it does, the changes and impacts I could make, I never knew that in school at all whatsoever. I just got told it's a youth parliament and you'll do some things, but I never actually realised what I can do, the work I can do, who I can talk to, and the opportunities that I can get from it as well. So it'll really make an impact on it, and a lot of young people I feel like would actually be interested more in SYP.
Thanks very much both for that. I think we're coming to the end of this panel, but I just wanted to give both you, Ramiza and Zainab, the opportunity to say, are there any things that you have remembered from previous questions that you want to make sure we are aware of, or anything that you think you'd like us to consider about how this committee works directly with your committee, or that we can support more generally the Scottish Parliament to work with the Youth Parliament? Ramiza, I'll come to you first, and then Zainab.
I think the questions were actually really great. I loved how everyone really did remember everything that we had said and had taken into consideration. It's really sweet. And on top of that, I really liked how everyone missed Fernando a little bit as well. But on top of that, it was really great to understand that people really took into consideration about the Cultural Awareness Month. And like I had emphasised, and even Zainab had emphasised, if we could work collectively and actually doing social media campaigns or events together, it will raise a huge awareness, and the young people of Scotland who come from a cultural background will actually feel like they're being represented a lot more. It's easily said that, okay, we have these people in Parliament, Youth Parliament, who are representing us, but actually seeing that they have a similar heritage or a background, it inspires people more. And there was just one more point I was wanting to add, if that was okay.
Of course.
It was to talk about the reconsideration of the UNCRC bill, if that's all right.
Yes, of course, carry on.
SYP has been slightly frustrated that there hasn't been a published timetable for the next stages of the UNCRC bill. with it's almost been 2 years since the bill was initially passed and the cost of living crisis leading to more rights issues for young people, it is disappointing that we have no further forward any information or anything. We want for young people to continue to be updated and included in the process if that is possible.
Thanks very much, Ramiza. We will have a discussion as a committee about what we do with that request. I think it's a request well made. Zainab, do you want to any final thoughts or comments from you, Zainab?
I just wanted to quickly go back to the question Karen asked regarding the statutes. And I wanted to bear my personal opinion regarding that. So I wanted to say that, yeah, the statue should be taken down because you're things of honour, but they could also be turned into things like writings on the floor. So it's not to erase history, because whether we like it or not, whether it was pleasant or not, history happened. And we need to make sure we don't erase history, because those who fail to learn from history are bound to repeat it. A popular, like, you know, phrase, which I really believe. So if we could turn it into like writers on the floor to show we don't support it, but we also recognize that this history happened and people deserve to know that this has actually happened, but we do not support it. If that is a great answer to that question. Mm-hmm. And I also want to talk about our right to food research that we're conducting in the SYP. It will be coming out in March, and I just asked if the committee could help by meeting with their local MSYPs to discuss the findings and, you know, help promote them. Because we're talking about the outreach of SYPs. So if MPs could meet with their local MSYPs, that would be really good.
Thanks very much for that, Zainab. I think we'll draw that session to a close now. But before, Ramiza, Zainab, you go, just to say thank you very much for joining us this morning. Thank you for your contributions. And you've given us a lot to think about. I think there are quite a few points that you've raised that we can discuss as a committee, how we take those forward, how we want to take those issues forward. I also would be interested, and I'm sure my committee colleagues would as well, please do keep us up to date. You know, let us know how things go with your action plan, how you're getting along with the work that you're doing, and if there are specific things that you would like for us to do to support, to share on social media and elsewhere, please. You know, come through our committee clerks and we will do what we can to support you. But we will keep in touch as well, and we will have a conversation later on this morning about the requests you've made of us and the comments you've made and how we can continue to work together over the coming months. So Ramiza, Zainab, thank you again very much. And I will now suspend the meeting briefly while we change over our panels. Thank you. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone. And the next item on our agenda is to take evidence on minimum core obligations from a human rights budgeting perspective. And I welcome this morning to the meeting Dr. Alison Hosey, Research Officer, and Luis Philippe Yanis, Legal Policy Development Officer from the Scottish Human Rights Commission. Alison is the Commission's lead on human rights budgeting, and Luis Philippe leads on economic, social, and cultural rights. Alongside them is Rob Watts. Welcome back, Rob. Rob is economist at the Fraser of Allender Institute. You're all very welcome. Thank you for joining us this morning. I refer members to papers 3 and 4 in our papers pack and invite our witnesses to make some opening remarks. I believe, Luis, you're going to kick things off. So over to you.
Thank you, Maggie. So we have different areas of expertise, so at times we'll sort of throw each other an apologies for the informality of at some point I might say maybe ask Ali or the other way around. So I think so. Thank you again for providing this opportunity to talk and discuss about minimum core obligations, and we're very excited to be able to do this as it's a really, really important area of ESC rights, which is very, very often not carefully considered and understood as well. So I think it's useful to start just a sort of general understanding of what minimum core obligations are. So under a sort of legal international standards as developed by the UN Committee on Economic, Social, Cultural Rights, which is the treaty monitoring body within the UN that monitors compliance of the covenant, so the covenant ratified by the UK. Minimum core obligations are those obligations that are essential and of such importance that if they are not complied with, the purpose itself of the treaty, of the covenant, would not be met. So they have to be complied, and they are not subject to progressive realisation and available resources. So in other words, and just maybe to provide with the committee with a very simple definition, what are minimum core obligations? So they are the obligations related to economic, social, and cultural rights, which a country needs to comply at all times and in all circumstances, regardless of their resources or the overall conditions of a country. If minimum core obligations are not met, a country is then not complying with its international legal obligations. We can understand these obligations in sort of two categories. One is related to results. So these are often viewed as obligations of entitlement. So for example, in relation to access to food or access to education, this is the right to have access to essential food stock or the right to have access to the most basic forms of free primary education. And then there's a different component, which is those of obligations of conduct. So that is no longer an entitlement itself, but the way that the state has to behave and the way the state has to act. So using health as an example, it's no longer about access, for example, to a specific medical service, but it's about an obligation, as part of minimum core obligations, an obligation to set forth a public health plan. So there you have an obligation of result and not necessarily, an obligation of conduct and not necessarily an obligation of result. I think it's really important to raise the fact that as of now, since the UK has ratified the covenant since 1976, minimum core obligations should be met in Scotland today, and duty bearers should be working tirelessly to ensure that they are complied with. So the process of incorporation, and I'm sure we'll talk about this today, reaffirms the legal commitments and ensures that there can be legal accountability for when minimum cores are not met. But that doesn't mean that as of now, given the ratification of the covenant, that they should be met in present time. I also want to make sure that we understand that minimum core obligations is one of sort of four inherent obligations that are intertwined and interdependent related to economic, social, and cultural rights. So there's four really important obligations that are attached to ESC rights. And I use ESC rights just to say economic, social, and cultural rights. So ESC rights are subject to progressive realization, so they have to be improved over time, and efforts needs to be made to ensure that the realization of rights can happen over time. but they are dependent on the maximum available resources. So you have to ensure that proper funding is placed in terms of its allocation and its mobilization and how you spend that money to ensure that you can progress, right? And there's a lot of overlap of why this is really relevant to the work that Ali and the Commission has done in relation to human rights budgeting. Then there is the third component of the obligations, which is what we're talking today, which is minimum core obligations and they're of immediate consequence. And then the final, which is, again, really important to mention, which is non-retrogression. So ensure that the level of enjoyment of the right is not, it is not regressed in any way. And if it is regressed, there is a very strict test of what are the reasonings to ensure that if it's met, then you have to provide. I want to conclude just by sharing a commission publication recently, which gives our overall analysis of what are the key legal features for the new human rights bill. And in that, we explained what new human rights bill needs to guarantee to ensure that it's maximalist, internationalist, multi-institutional and world leading, as the National Task Force indicated. Our analysis mostly based on international legal standards and best comparative examples across the world. And I think it's useful just to mention the sort of four essential elements that we've said need to be guaranteed in relation to minimum core. So what have we said? The first thing is we recommend that an obligation should be placed on relevant duty bearers to ensure that the minimum essential levels of economic, social, cultural and environmental rights for people to be able to live a dignified life is always met. The second is that these essential levels must be defined in further secondary legislation after a participatory process has taken place, which includes taking careful consideration of the people, of those with lived experience, technical expertise, and policymakers. The third, the secondary legislation should be reviewed every 10 years to ensure that essential levels are a reflection of the technological, societal, financial, and environmental realities of Scotland. The process should continue to ensure that those with lived experience, technical expertise, and policymakers are the basis of any change. The fourth and final, the legislation should include an impossibility test that allows for duty bearers to avoid and only be able to avoid responsibility if they are able to prove that, in spite of all of its efforts, it could not comply with achieving its minimum core obligations. So we look forward to discussing both today on minimum core obligations and also very happy in the future as well to talk more about what we consider are the key essential legal features from a human rights perspective for the Human Rights Bill. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Louise. Ali and Rob, are you happy for us just to move straight into questions now, or would you like to say a few opening words too? Rob?
Yeah, go on then. I've got a little, just
go
1 minute, 2 minutes.
Go for it.
So, hello, welcome. It's great to be back. So I'm an economist at the Fraser Valander Institute, so I don't have a background in human rights and law, so some of the more technical legal questions might need to defer to the experts. But I do have some understanding of how minimum core obligations could be applied to the budget, both the process of setting the budget and the decisions, the content of the budget, and some thoughts on some practical next steps that we might want to take. And so in the briefing I prepared last year, I set out some of the principles and the concepts that underpin human rights and how they might be applied to the budget. And one of those is minimum core obligations. And it could be a useful tool, minimum core obligations, to help scrutinise and ultimately influence budget decisions. Part of the challenge is that minimum core obligations aren't always clearly defined. And I think it's important to understand that minimum core obligations started out as a concept, not like a list of standards. And our task is to apply this concept to Scotland's human rights framework, and to establish what they mean for us. So, yeah, looking forward to this discussion.
Great. Thanks very much, Rob. If I can just start things off then. Louise, you mentioned the importance of participation and having a participatory process to determine, in some cases, that final point that Rob made there about what do we actually mean when we're talking about minimum core obligations. We don't necessarily have this list of things, but what are they? Can you outline about a little bit about how that participatory process should take place so we actually have Scotland-wide understanding of what these are before we come to Scotland-wide, hopefully, meeting of these obligations?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Maggie. It's a really, really, really important question. And I should say One of the exciting things of the legislation is that this would be quite a sort of world-leading process that hasn't necessarily been done before. And that has a lot to do because the way that minimum core obligations have usually been defined is by judicial interpretation. So you might have, as Rob was saying, a sort of wider concept, and that might be applied on a case-by-case basis. And we can go into some of those examples later if that is relevant. But in terms of the process itself, there's sort of two or three stages, I would say. There's the first stage that you need the legislation to be able to have a wider concept, a wider definition, right? So we've suggested minimum essential levels of economic, social and cultural and environmental rights necessary to live a dignified life. That concept could be different. Some countries have looked into more a sort of survivalist approach, so necessary to survive, and it's quite a bare minimum. Other countries have looked at dignified life. So you need first that definition. Now, that definition needs to be the sort of what grounds and guides the process of then defining that list or making up that list. So the process itself, so there are temptations, and we've explored in much, much careful sort of consideration of what would be the best case. And there's temptations at times of looking at, for example, a citizens' assembly type of model of maybe being the process and the place to define minimum core. Now, what our analysis is that there are potential risks of that process in that space, particularly because what we want to ensure is that those most vulnerable are heard carefully and are considered as a matter of priority. So participation in this process can't be seen as a matter of consensus. It can't be about reaching a consensus and voting. It's about how a process is hearing everyone in the country, hearing those most vulnerable, hearing technical expertise, and then coming up with a sort of more final view. We think the process potentially could last around 2 to 3 years. So what will be, in our view, one of the sort of best models, it will be something set up as a sort of independent commission, independent committee, like the Mental Health Review Panel, for example, that has various types of expertise, including those, you know, sort of more technical legal expertise, policymakers, people with lived experience in the panel, that would convene a process of hearing as many people as possible and ensuring that a prioritized scheme is there. Right. So you want to make sure that those potentially with less of a strong voice and those not necessarily with the sort of ability to express the sort of policy considerations in general are met and are defined in that process. And then the idea is that is presented to government and to parliament for then for secondary legislation to be introduced. So that's the sort of steps that we would see. But I think what is really, really relevant is to not confuse sort of participation and acknowledgement of people's lived experience with consensus. Because there's a risk of that, and then if we're reaching consensus, maybe those most vulnerable are not really prioritised in the scheme.
Okay. Thanks, Louise. Ali, do you have anything to add to
that? No, nothing to add to that. That's what as we discussed.
Okay, great. Rob?
Just some brief thoughts. I think, firstly, so Parliament does consultations, right? But this is not that. This is not, you know, a window where the public can engage if they want to. This is, you know, active engagement with duty bearers and rights holders on an ongoing basis. And generally speaking, to get there, I think one thing we have to do is we have to build capacity of understanding the contents of the human rights obligations in government and across public authorities to help them when they're engaging in that process. Mm-hmm. And the other thing to note is that we have existing like human rights infrastructure in Scotland, like these guys. If we could properly resource that, I'd say that's quite an essential first part of getting this participatory process right.
Thanks, Rob. That's helpful. I think particularly that distinction between what we need to do with this and our normal consultation processes as well. Karen, I'll come to you next.
Hello, hi. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yes,
there's
we can.
A slight delay, sorry. Hi, good morning to the panel. It's really great to hear from you all today. It's just a really crucial part, I think, of our work here on the committee really is delving more into core obligations. I'd like to know what it would look like in practice. We've heard some suggestions that minimum core obligations should be more relative than universal. I
almost find that counterintuitive as to what court obligations should be. So I would really like to hear your views on what you think about a flexible approach in regards to the relativeness, or a more universal catch-all approach.
Ali? Yep, do you want to?
Ali? Yep.
It's a good question. I think the first point here is that the threshold of the minimum can't go below that universal minimum. That is the globally set universal minimum. And as Louis noted in the opening statement, the universal approach outlining a set of obligations that if they were not complied with, then the whole purpose of the treaty would disappear. So the obligations of the treaty itself would no longer make any sense. And so they need to be complied with at all times, regardless of our resources as a country. So this universal minimum is what the UN committee has developed over many years through its general comments and general statements. And now this isn't something, as Rob said, it's not something, unfortunately, that's been collated together nicely in a neat package by the UN. But this needs to be our starting point. And so Louis has actually produced this, which we will leave with you, which brings together the last 30 years of general comments and statements around all of the different rights, drawing together that information for you where it exists. And the baseline, in other words, this baseline is a universal minimum. So the obligations can't fall below that, that standard. It can only go above them. The only approach of minimum core as a universal standard is that set up by the committee. So it's the interpretive authority of the treaty. And if we think about it carefully, countries that have adopted a minimum core in their judicial interpretation or by enacting elements of it in different pieces of legislation, those who have domesticated the concept in one way or another, are always based on the relative minimum, the universal minimum, even if regardless of resources. So a country doesn't necessarily have the resources that the UK and Scotland does. For example, in Colombia, it will still, when you look at their practice of judicial interpretation of what is the vital minimum, I'm not saying that right, Louis always gets that right, it is higher. Okay. So perhaps actually in terms of the other countries and examples, Louis is best placed to take that further.
No, I mean, I could just add to that I see, Karen, of the, I think the concept can be a bit counterintuitive and it does feel sound problematic. But effectively, the reality is that the relative minimum as applied in most countries, and we can talk about some examples like Germany, Colombia, Belgium, Switzerland, Brazil, Argentina, is always beyond the universal minimum. So if you're convening a process to define the minimum core obligations, as we'll see here, the starting point is the global minimum, right? So because the committee is trying to make sure that you're setting up a standard for every country in the world. So it's very minimalistic. So if you look at, sort of, for example, the right to food, it's basic essential nutrition to be able to survive. So it's not even about adequate food. It's not about nutritious, rich, nice cultural food. It's about, you know, sort of basic. So that's your starting point. And then the relative minimum is how do you go beyond that? And how much are we willing as a sort of fair country to go beyond that threshold to ensure, and what we're proposing, a dignified life standard. So that will be the relative minimum, something that goes beyond the sort of basic universal one.
That's really helpful. Thank you.
Thanks, Karen. Rob, do you have anything you want to add to that?
Yeah, just a brief reflection from an economist's perspective, because when I think of this, I often think I relate it to poverty, and we have the statutory child poverty targets, and the headline, one of the headlines in that is relative poverty. And there's a reason that's the figure that most economists will defer to. It's because if we think of poverty as being a level below which if you need a minimum means of resources to live an acceptable standard of living, and what people consider to be acceptable changes over time, and that's why we defer to relative. And so if, for example, we went for this kind of universalist, survivalist definition of minimum core obligations, where, you know, Lewis was talking about, you know, the food, the right to adequate food being just enough to literally survive, you know, in the future, that might not be meaningful or legitimate for a future Scotland. Yeah. And so surely there needs to be some kind of flexibility to build on that.
Okay. Thanks, Rob. That's helpful. Karen, is there anything else you want to explore on this? Is that you?
No. I'm grateful for the answers. I think that has explained it really well to me, and particularly from an economist's point of view, because that was something that was you know, ringing alarm bells with me was this relativeness rather than universal, and it's great to have that explained, so thank you.
Thanks, Karen. Pam Duncan-Glancy, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thank you for your opening statements and for answering the questions we've had so far. It's been really helpful. Taking probably what we've just discussed a little bit more specifically, in evidence that we've had, and I think, Dr. Hosey, you said this in your evidence last time, that food poverty and food bank use, for example, suggest that we're not really delivering a minimum core. So where do the panel think we are in international standards? So if we've got the global minimum and then we've got this relative concept there, where are we on that? And where should we be starting as a committee to look at the minimum core?
I got that. It's a really good question. I think when you're thinking about the global minimum core and any relative, I think the most important thing to recognise is that it is such a basic level, universal, that we can't drop below that. So if we are looking at a relative minimum core, if we're achieving that, we will be achieving the universal. But if we're not, we have to look if we're actually achieving that lower level. And it comes down to how we monitor. We need to look very carefully at whether or not we are meeting that minimum core. And to be honest, right now, we're not measuring what we need to measure. We don't have the data available to us to be able to see right now where we are. We've got lots of different bits and pieces of evidence, but we were talking about this in preparation for today, and we were thinking that there's a lot of evidence that we don't have access to. The committee will be more than aware in terms of disaggregated equality data. But also, as a commission, you know, it's something that we see that could be a really, we would have a strong role in doing that monitoring. But we don't currently have the resources to be able to do that properly. And we also don't have the correct powers. We were looking at how we, is it Colombia has got the South Africa has got a really good system where they can compel evidence. They can compel public authorities to provide information. Whereas we have written previously to different public authorities asking them for information on certain things and they haven't replied. And they don't have to reply. And potentially their legal departments will tell them that it's advisable not to reply to us. And so what, you know, if they don't have to, they don't provide the data. So there are certain things that we could look at in terms of how you can better place our organisation and others like us to be able to have access to the right information to make those assessments. So that would be the first part.
If I can add to that, it's a really important question, Pam, and it talks about, you know, we can talk about this theoretically and then it's, you know, what's happening right now on the ground. And so, for example, in our report, in our recent report last few weeks ago to the Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights and the reporting of the current status of enjoyment of ESC rights in Scotland, we express our concerns over two specific issues. First, high levels of food insecurity and have high levels of homelessness. But as Ali was saying, we don't have the sufficient data and access or the ability to collect that data, the powers or the resources to then say unequivocally, Scotland is breaching its minimum core. So we can express concern and we are concerned, we're highly concerned, but we don't know if we're passing that threshold and we don't know the impacts of that threshold either. And that is the sort of problematic stand we're in which we see things of concern, but and we're willing to do the work, but we're not really able to. And we're not able on a sort of systemic nature to say, this is what's happening in Scotland, and even this is what's happening in regions, because you can have, let's say, food insecurity. There might be quite different in Central Belt than in island communities, and that might require a different type of action to take for different local authorities. Again, we're not able to get to that determination.
So it's a hard question to answer, and I found this when I was doing the briefing last year, is that there's always examples that you can point to where it looks like a minimum core issue. So, for example, mine was on people with learning disabilities. There's a number of people with learning disabilities effectively detained in hospitals. There's no medical need for them to be there. It's just because we can't put together a care package in the community. And in the UNCRPD, there's, I think it's Article 19, this right to independent living in the community. That looks like, to me, like a minimum core issue. But that's an example, right? I think the question, really, to answer your question well, we have to work on this, what is the definition? So then you can have a more like system-wide objective assessment of where are we, rather than just picking out examples. But to get to that point, yeah, we need to work on defining minimum core obligations, and then we know what we're measuring. I think we might get onto this, but when we talk about measurement and data and stuff, do we want to use a measure to define what we mean by minimum core, or do we want to define what a minimum core obligation is, and from there we decide what to measure? And I would say probably we need to do that first bit before we can do the second bit and answer your question comprehensively.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And yeah, that's an interesting kind of way to put it, actually. What do we do first? So we'll maybe have to have a wee think about that and probably come back to you guys for expertise on it. Just to pick up, if it's all right, Louis, on your point around measurement and data, are both the availability of data and the gathering of evidence and data and your ability to compel that to be provided, are both of those things an issue, or is it just the both? Okay. So that kind of links into my next question, which was how can we measure whether we're meeting those obligations? But also, how can we measure whether the state's used all its resources? Like, how can we measure whether we have maximised the resources in terms of the relative provision? Like, where do we start?
Great question. I'll let Ali start and I'll jump into the end of that.
Okay. I mean, effectively, there's a three-stage process here, which relates to the process of how we approach the budget that you have heard me talk about many times. You monitor your human rights obligations, and once you've got a clear picture of compliance on minimum core, based on whatever indicators you have set up, you then see what the key issues are and where progress has been made or where it hasn't been made. And you then explore that in relation to your resources. So what resources are required to be generated and allocated based on that need? And then the final stage of that is when you scrutinise and monitor how the budgeting process has been done, where the money has been spent, and what impact it has had based on that initial assessment of your need. For the committee to approach human rights budget scrutiny, it would have to have all of that data available on what currently is the enjoyment of minimum core obligations, so what are the issues at stake, and then cross-cut that with how the government is planning to spend or prioritise its resources based on that. And another point on the monitoring, I suppose it goes back to the question about the relative or minimum, universal minimum core, is that, as Louis mentioned before, we already signed up to the convention, and we should be doing this monitoring already of the universal level. But if we develop a more relative set of minimum core obligations, once this is agreed by the country, then you would want to focus on monitoring that. And as I said before, if you're achieving that, then you will be achieving the universal. And if not, then you need to dig a bit deeper to make sure that you are actually achieving the universal. But if you're not compliant with it, then you may still be compliant with the universal because it is such a low level. But with regard also to monitoring, you have to be able to monitor both the minimum core and your progressive realisation. And that's one of the key things around compliance with the minimum, is that you then it becomes very comparative. You'd need to be able to monitor what happened last year and what happened in the last cycle. And the more disaggregated data that you have, the better. So you'll be able to see things as they change. You'll be able that you need to understand why things have gone up or why things have gone down, and also how it's impacting on different groups. And then the final stage is that the budget monitoring. And we have this minimum core and progressivity, and now we look at where the available resources have been placed. And we can maybe see the decisions that have been based on the evidence of need. But when you ask in relation to generation of resources, I think it goes back to the point I made at the committee last time, was that how we approach the budget, instead of approaching it with your budget, this is the size of your budget, how do we divide it up? Even if you are aware of what your minimum core, what your needs are, you turn it around and you start with your obligations, and you start with where the need is in relation to your minimum core. And then you look at what do we need to do to improve that? What are the resources required to do that? And how are we going to generate those resources? So it's that way of, instead of start, and I know that there are complications in relation to Scotland and its powers and in relation to tax, something else I've talked about before, but there are different things that we can do and are starting to do, but there's more that we could do. And it's that's how you look at starting from what you need and working out to then dividing that amongst the areas that require the resources.
Thank you.
If I could just add quickly, two things for that. First, on your first question, Pam, in terms of is it lack of available data, is it powers, is it both? I think it's exacerbated by the fact that it is both. So it would be less problematic if there was wide available data, but it will still be at times problematic because it depends on the available data, because sometimes if it's not sufficiently disaggregated, then an NHRI might still not be able to really determine well what's happening. So a great example, as Ali was mentioning, is the South Africa Human Rights Commission, because it has a power under the constitution, so under its sort of enabling law, to be able to compel information, and it creates its own indicators. So you might create a set of list of issues or a set of questions that you actually send. For example, just to imagine a sort of creative, innovative where we could be, we have a list of questions where we ask specific data to local authorities and different public bodies. Can you inform us of the amount of people who are accessing health services on this? Can you provide information on this? So you have a list of questions, you create the indicators, you're able to monitor that on a yearly or quarterly basis. So that is really key in terms of how you create indicators based on the data. That gives you an understanding of the wider issue, but not the individual issue. And I think that we have to go into that discussion, right? So that can still give you a picture of, oh, there's huge levels of homelessness in the country, but who are the victims of that? Mm. And that's a different approach, because that is just looking at wider issues and not necessarily the victim itself. So there's two areas there to explore. But I want to finish with what we've proposed on the task force, our work as well, in relation to the potential human rights scheme in the incorporation bill. Similar to the children's rights scheme in the UNCRC, if the scheme was working effectively, for example, a duty bearer would have to, in its reporting mechanism, provide some of that data that we urgently need to know. So it's about planning. So how am I going to allocate resources? How am I going to tackle the problematic issues within my area of remit? And then how I report on the progress of that. And the potential of the scheme becoming a quite more coherent way of meeting the obligations, planning and reporting would be quite fundamental. So a lot to also think about the relevance of a potential human rights scheme in the new bill.
Thank you. That's really helpful. I think from that there's a lot to do. Did you want to add something to that, Rob?
Okay, briefly, I was just going to add that when we're talking about indicators, we're talking about monitoring, right?
Yeah.
So to tell how. And we need to flip this question to government and to public authorities, because how are they satisfied that they've met their obligations if they don't have the data available? And I think that comes back to a point I made earlier about capacity building in government and whether analysts really understand the content of human rights obligations and then providing relevant information to ministers and other duty bearers.
Thank you.
Rachel just wants to come in on a brief supplementary, then I'll come back to you, Pam.
Thank you.
It's just to Louis, regarding the UNCRC, we heard from the MSYPs that they're disappointed that the Scottish Government have failed to bring forward a timetable with regards to amendments and bringing that bill back to Parliament. What can the SHRC do with the current powers that they have to hold the government to account?
So I don't want to have a very long response, because I think there's a whole of the history of how the commission was set up and some of the powers that we don't have that were seen as not needed. And maybe there's a quite different reflection of that as of now. So we have a wider power to promote human rights, and that's quite understood quite broadly. That includes being here, for example, explaining and providing guidance and general expertise. We have a power to intervene in legal proceedings, but that it's not necessarily about raising the proceeding. We can only intervene in a specific legal proceeding. We don't have a power to raise a proceeding, so we can't litigate. We can't bring government to account, for example. We have a power to do an inquiry, but our power is quite limited in the way it was framed. So in reality, if we are to make an inquiry, we have to investigate all relevant public authorities of similar nature. So if we were concerned about homelessness in Glasgow, the part of the inquiry would have to investigate all local authorities of Scotland, which has made that, given our current resources, it would effectively make it impossible to ever do an inquiry. So again, that is widely sort of the powers that we currently have. And we've been engaging quite extensively about the potential new powers that the Commission could have in the incorporation bill. UNCRC would allow us, if brought back and passed, would allow us to raise proceedings on the UNCRC, but of course there is the existence of the Children's Rights Commissioner, so that would be working more collaboratively and not necessarily just on our own.
Can I ask another one on that?
Okay.
Rob, in the last session, when you gave evidence here, which was very useful. You talked about enshrining rights in Scots law, which will place obligations on the Scottish Government to deliver a minimum core element of each right for everyone. Now, clearly, the Scottish Government have come across a stumbling block with the UNCRC. So, using that example, how would the minimum core element of that particular bill, when it's not being delivered, work?
Honestly, I don't know how to answer that. I don't know, but I can get back to you. I'm not
that's
in
okay.
The
so I'll make
CRC,
it. I'll make it a little bit simpler, without using that example. Your point was that enshrining rights into Scots law would deliver the minimum core element, or the Scottish Government would be under an obligation to do that. But how does that actually work in practice? So I'm trying to use the UNCRC, but so say we're enshrining rights into Scots law. Is this the issue? Is that the minimum core obligation, it's not really possible to deliver that alongside that without making that part of the legislation as well?
Yeah. I suppose I'm going to sub you in, Lewis, but I think it's along the lines of at what point, because I think your question is about how do you go from having minimum core obligations written down to making them happen in practice? And I think that comes into the judicial process, but I don't know. I don't know if Lewis has anything more useful.
Thank you, Richard. I think so. I would split into two processes, and getting to the point of what you're saying. I think, and I would really want to emphasise on this, the government is on an obligation to meet minimum core obligations now, today. And there are questions if they are meeting them, and we'll leave you the full list of what they are, right? Now, there is no process to hold anyone accountable in Scotland if they are not being met. And so there's and that is the sort of nature of our wider sort of legal arrangement in which international law is not directly applicable in any judicial setting, right? So in other countries, for example, if you're in the Netherlands, we could hold the government to account even if there was no process internally to have defined anything, right? But as we don't do that, and we don't have that, we can't hold them to account, but they should be meeting them because there is a commitment since 1976 of having ratified the UN Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights. So what we want to do with the incorporation bill is now have the ability to make sure that duty bearers have to act to comply with their legal obligations, and if they fail, to be able to bring them to court. But that's different from what they should be doing today. So that's, I think, the bit of a split. They should be complying with it. Unfortunately, if they're not, we can't do much. That's the reality. And I think these processes, a committee like this, has an important role, because there is no judicial ability to intervene, has an important role of that scrutiny.
Okay. I've kind of jumped on to question 10, if you want me to finish this part.
I'll come back to Pam and then come back to you at the end, if that's Pam. Okay. Pam.
It's okay. I suspect, actually, we may be about to ask the same thing, but I hope I don't cut across you, Rachel. I just actually, on the final point you made there, what options are available to us to uphold the minimum core, and what have we got now, what would we need in the future, so that if we see a circumstance, and Rob's highlighted one that I think actually really is quite a good example, to be honest, of where we may not be meeting almost a kind of basic minimum, actually, how do we enforce it, and what powers do you need, what powers do courts need, do individuals need, do parliamentarians need, that kind of area?
Would that be pre-incorporation or post-incorporation? Both.
Good question, back to me. Both, actually, yeah. In order for us to be able to determine any of this now, because I'm conscious that actually the minimum core is, as we've already heard, we should be doing that now. But post-incorporation as well, the purpose of incorporation is to make things more real, make rights more real for people, surely. So, yeah, what do we need pre and post?
So, now, today, the starting point is what we're going to leave you, the list. on having clarity of what they are under international legal standards. The next step in the now would be either to attempt to scrutinise that, try to find relevant information, either by the committee requesting responses from specific public authorities of how can they report on various issues. So that might be local authorities, that might be calling the Scottish Housing Regulator, for example, to see if they can provide some data. That could be calling on government ministers as well to provide NHS, etc. It could also be, for example, by exploring into funding a specific project. That could be by the committee or by ourselves into sort of really looking into determine what's the current reach. The reality is, even if we had the powers, we currently don't have the resources as well to be able to give, you know, such a level of determination on that. So I think that is the first step as of what we could do now, and the type of scrutiny that yourselves could do. And then when we reach that information and what type of picture that information presents, then the type of scrutiny that you might want to present within Parliament and government. That's the pre-incorporation. The post-incorporation, I would say, requires a various degrees of issues and I think modifications. So for one degree, we've called, and again, we can talk about our wider view of the bill at a later stage. We believe that Parliament has an important role to play, and this committee has an important role to play in the scrutiny of wider human rights issues and legislation. The Commission would have to have powers that are modified. So that would include, for example, as Ali has mentioned, the power to compel information. But also, we would ideally, there would be need to reflection about how our inquiry power is modified, how we have a softer power to do investigations. There are countries where, for example, an inquiry into issues like these ends with a determination that is binding. And therefore, there's less of the need of having to have the judiciary intervene because there's sort of binding non-judicial interventions, let's call them. The scheme, again, is very important into that. So there is, I would say there's, and then, sorry, and the final bit is the judicial intervention. And that requires a few things. So we've talked about this impossibility test. So very strong inability to defend yourself. So it has to be a very big threshold if you're not complying with them. But there's also a reflection of wider access to justice. So we've called on the process of incorporation to ensure that our routes to judicial and non-judicial remedies are in accordance to international legal standards, particularly what we call the AATE framework. So they have to be accessible, they need to be affordable, they need to be timely, and they need to be effective. And we have big questions about how much do we actually have judicial and non-judicial routes to remedy that are accessible, affordable, timely, and effective. So to ensure, again, now this is no longer the monitoring wider structure issue, it's the individual. So an individual who is suffering and is not being, and its obligations minimum core not being met, what can it do? And so there's questions about ensuring that there are accessible, affordable, timely, and effective remedies, and that institutions like an NHRI, like ourselves, is able to provide also the support, guidance, and powers to litigate on their behalf is also quite essential. Taking the burden out of the individual and marginalised communities to be able to support those who might require it is also an important step.
Thank you. Thank you.
Anyone else on the panel want to come in on that? Otherwise, I will move on to... Yes, Ali.
Just to give a practical example on the impossibility test, because I know we're talking quite theoretically today, but something practical that in relation to your right to culture, your cultural rights, the state has to provide access to, through your local authorities, to libraries, to pools, to communal facilities. And if there was a massive flood and a whole area was deprived, many people deprived of their homes, some of those facilities might have to be used to provide accommodation, temporary accommodation for a mass flood incident. That would be an example of the impossibility test where the local authority cannot provide those services because they are being provided for another purpose that's more important. So just to give a practical example.
That's helpful. A brief follow-up to that.
Yes, okay.
Thank you. Is there usually a time limit on an impossibility test? Because that example you've just given reminds me of what happened in COVID and libraries and public public centres were closed to provide vaccination centres, etc. Mm. Is there a timescale attached?
No, and there needs to be guidance for the judicial interpretation to be clear. Okay. So it would have to have demonstrated why it still couldn't, right? So if you say, well, I was still in the process of doing X, Y, Z, and I was still reaccommodating people, these buildings were flooded, we couldn't move the people and so on. So that clearly falls within that. Mm-hmm. If you then reach to a point and say, well, we see clear inaction, we see, you know, quite incoherent policy making. We don't see, you were using resources to do that, and you were building this new facilities that were completely unnecessary, but you weren't doing that, then you're clearly seeing an issue about having met and sort of beyond the sort of threshold that you would need.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Pam. I'll move to Kirkab.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm usually on the Education Committee and I've come over today, so I'd quite like to look at education and drill down into how the minimum core obligations apply to that. So if we accept that everyone has a right to education and they have a place, so in Scotland, you know, we know that the curriculum is based loosely on sort of Bloom's, but sitting beside that, of course, is sort of, you know, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And I'm wondering, where do the minimum core obligations fit with that? If you think of it as a pyramid and it's sitting on sand, so do the core obligations, are they the sand underneath that hierarchy of needs, or is it part of that? So that's my opening gambit. And Louis, you look as though you're itching to get in there with a response.
I think I was purposely sit on the middle to be sort of So it's a great question. It's an absolutely great question. And I think so if you see it from the universalist approach defined by the committee, it's always, again, it's trying to build a degree of consensus among all countries, right? So it's going to be the minimalistic. So it says, for example, the provision of the most basic forms of primary education. That is not necessarily a good education, most basic forms of free primary education. And free primary education, of course, that is in the word of the text. So Article 13 of the International Covenant does guarantee the right to free primary education. So therefore, the minimum core has to be, at the very least, free basic primary education. It does put a question what Scotland does, right? Because we have free secondary education. We have three undergraduate higher education to some degree. So are we satisfied with the universal minimum standard of just saying basic forms of free primary education, or do we want to go beyond that, right? Do we want to at the very least say three secondary education, free secondary inclusive education, free good secondary education, or, you know, so it can be very much up to Scotland to define that. It can be below that, but it can be above that. The other really important aspect, again, very minimalistic, has to do with non-discrimination education, right? So if you're providing whatever form of basic education, it has to be provided on a non-discriminatory manner. So the minimum core has to be, you can't just provide for men and not for women, or for a specific ethnic minority and not the other. So that's very clear of the basics that align.
Okay. I'll come back to that point, actually. I had the international sort of comparators there, but I'll stick with education. So, Rob, you mentioned the word survive, and I'm passionate about education. It's for everyone to thrive through education, but we know that the impact of poverty, so whilst resources can be put into frontline education and, you know, a child has a place, they have a classroom, they have a teacher in front of them, they have the books, they have all that. But in spite of that, we do know that children who are living in unsafe housing, precarious sort of personal, all of that. So I'm alluding to the poverty-related attainment gap here. So where does, or what's your opinions about, again, the minimum core? You know, I'm looking at resources and where they're targeted. So would that be on housing, health? We know it's all interconnected, and I'm not expecting a black and white answer as such, but it'd be good to hear your opinion on that.
Right, so I brought with me here the UN, it's a general comment on health, so it's not related to education, but it's kind of the same point. And it starts to spell out, actually starts dictating what a minimum core obligations could be. It does list some. And in there, I thought it would all be like healthcare, like defining what it means by minimum standard of healthcare, but actually it talks about ensuring minimum essential food, which is nutritionally adequate and safe, ensuring basic shelter, housing and sanitation, and so on. So I guess your point about education is we think about education as like, are we resourcing schools and does everyone have access to schools? But there's other factors that determine a child's ability to achieve a good education. And we probably want to think about that when we're defining a minimum core obligation around the right to education. But yeah, and this is where the point comes in about this is a minimum floor.
Okay, so I'm thinking of like free school meals. Would that be a good example then? Because, I mean, if you've got a child sitting in a classroom with the best teacher in the world and you've got everything in front of them, but if they're hungry and they've not had the breakfast and they're not going to eat, their priority is going to be their hunger. So that is going to prevent them from thriving in education and learning. So that investment then, that money that goes into sort of like feeding children or housing children or maternal health care, for instance. So it's a complex picture. That's what I suppose that's what I'm trying to get to, that, you know, that right to education, the sand goes into all sorts of different areas.
Yeah, so I mean, these guys, correct me if I'm wrong, but I would say that probably when, it depends how we want to define minimum core, and I don't want to start saying what it should look like, but when you talk about free school meals, we probably don't want to say, like, use free school meals as a definition, but you might want to say ensuring that every child has a nutritious diet, and then free school meals could be a way of achieving that or measuring that.
Yeah, no, that's a fair point, and that's not what I meant. I was just using it as an illustrative example. I would like families to have access to good, nutritious food that, you know, they can have. I realise that time might be a little bit tight, convener, but if I could just, that international...
Sorry, Kirkab, I think Ali might want to come back on that point, and we've got time.
Yeah, no,
so
brilliant, thank you.
No, I was just thinking in terms of how we not fixate on just the minimum core, but think about the progressive realisation. So, as Rob said, you know, the universal minimum, it is there so that there's no point in setting a relative minimum in Scotland if we are going to fail to achieve it at the first outing and every subsequent outing thereafter. You want to set it at a level that is relative to dignity, that is, you know, is perhaps above the universal minimum, but it has to be achievable without, you know, apart from impossibility situations. And then you want to be looking for your stretch targets, your benchmarks to show that you are making progress. And so that the access to for every child to have, you know, a meal in their tummy when they come to school, you'd think, yes, that's a basic. But what that should be for every child, or what level of nutrition, or what, there's different elements there that you could put into the measurement over time. So to think about it, not just minimum core, but to think about what it is that you're trying to achieve overall and look at those as the steps that you're wanting to measure progress in.
Okay, thank you.
Rachel wanted to come in very quickly just on this specific point.
Thank you, convener. Well, excuse my scepticism, but the Patients' Rights Scotland Act 2011 set out a 12-week minimum treatment guarantee, and that's a legal obligation, and that is being failed all the time. So how can we set minimum core obligations when not even a legal mandate is being followed?
The difficult questions come to the middle. So I think that's a really good point and a really important question. I wouldn't say that necessarily falls within the scope of minimum core obligations. I mean, that could be made into a minimum core obligation, but that's not necessarily it. And I think to sort of reiterate Ali's point of how do you define minimum core as sort of non-negotiable, right? So I sort of, in my opening statement, I sort of mentioned, you know, the obligations that have to be met at all times, regardless of the conditions and the available resources. So that would put a question into the process that we mentioned in the back about the sort of participatory process and the definition of, is that a type of obligation that we see as non-negotiable, not subject to available resources, and so essential that it requires, that is necessary to live a dignified life? Or is that actually more part of what we say within the sort of progressive realization obligations, right? And I think, and to reiterate, because it's also in relation to the education question, is, as I mentioned, there are sort of two ways that are not necessarily contradictory, but there are two ways of looking at minimum core obligations. One is in relation to conduct, so how the state conducts itself and how it operates and the type of obligations of how it implements something, and some are in relation to outcomes, entitlements, right? So you can think about, if I actually have sort of the list of the right to education, so you think about some of the process one, ensure the right to access to public educational institutions on a non-discriminatory basis. So you don't have to guarantee the access, but the access that you have to guarantee has to be on a non-discriminatory basis. For example, that's a conduct obligation, very clearly non-negotiable. You have to ensure non-discriminatory access to education. But then, entitlement, so result, provide basic free primary education for everyone, right? So you see these two different types, outcomes and conduct. And it would be up to Scotland, if it wants to be mixed, if it wants to determine only on process base or on outcomes base. And I think that sort of misses with that. But just to say on that, Rachel, it will depend on how Scotland defines that. And I think it will be very troubling if it defines obligations as essential minimum that it is foreseeable that it cannot comply with.
Right, thank you. Very useful. Back to you, Coco.
Thank you. Thanks for that. I'll move on to the international sort of a reference on that. I'm just curious. You just mentioned and remind us about the right to free primary education. Now, we know that there are countries across the world that don't provide that. But the other phrase that I picked out was the bit about retrogressive. Yeah. So I'd like to hear a little bit more about that. Those measures, such as limiting the education of women and girls. So what role can the Commission play, other governments play, any of us? What can we do about that? Because that is happening right now, that rights that are already there are being taken away, and it's highly concerning.
So I would say there's a bit of a difference of the role of Parliament, government, this committee in relation to what happens in the country and what happens elsewhere, and the type of sort of scrutiny that this committee could do of its own government versus potentially what it could do of internationally. And so the UN Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, for example, in its processes has acute concerns, obviously, of certain countries in relation to the provision of free primary education, that the discriminatory basis of access to some education. And I won't list necessarily all those countries, because it's standard on the Paris principles of an NHRI to not engage on the work of other countries, as our mandate is in relation to Scotland. I think there's a question. So again, we've talked about this to some degree in our work in relation to non-retrogression. So there is... There usually is a sort of de facto, that the obligation is perceived as is non-retrogression is prohibited. So you should never either de facto, so in practice or in law, introduce retrogressive measures. But there are, of course, certain circumstances in retrogression is permissible, right? So Ali was mentioning sort of the instance of flooding. So you might have circumstances where you might want to limit the access to some service to be able to enjoy another. COVID is an example to some degree. You have there's a question of limitations, but there's a question of retrogression. Financial crisis tends to be an example of resources needed to be sort of remobilized, moved into elsewhere to be able to guarantee. The question here, just to sort of highlight, is how non-retrogression interacts with minimum core, right? Mm. And the standard always is, if you have no other choice and you have to introduce a retrogressive measure, you should never start by doing that on a minimum core obligation, right? It's your very last resource. If you have to cut, for example, funding from the provision of free primary education, or you have to cut funding from different areas, free primary education should be the last one where you cut the funding, right? Because that is part of your minimum core obligation. So you would have to ensure that the retrogressive measures that are put in place are prioritizing particularly minimum core obligations and those most vulnerable.
Okay. So from what you've said, I think my original question, you've used flooding as an example, whereas the withdrawal of the right of women and girls to education, I don't see that's not a response to an emergency measure or anything like the building collapsing. That would be a matter of ideology, I think. So I think that was the point. And this doesn't cover that, does it?
No, I meant in wider context, not necessarily targeted to a specific group.
Right.
The covenant is very clear on equality and non-discrimination, and they are very, very limited instances in which a situation like that would be permissible. And if I'm honest, I can't necessarily come up with one now. And that's the level of prohibition, right? Yeah. That you would have. So it is questionable about countries, of course, that introduce these type of restrictions. And I think it's up to members of you know, the parliament and government to enact in its sort of policy of how it pressures other countries in that relation.
Yeah, thank you, convener.
Ali, do you want to come in on
this? To add, in terms of the domestic situation, that in terms of retrogression, that's where your maximum available resources obligation also comes in, that you have to have looked at all other possible alternatives before making a retrogressive step, and one of those would be, are there other ways in which you can raise resources before you make cuts?
Okay. Thanks, Kirkhead. I'll move to Fulton now. Over to you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Thanks very much for your evidence so far. You've actually covered quite a lot of the area that I was going to ask about, as often happens when you're the last questioner. But really, if you're thinking about the incorporation into Scots law that we're hopeful be coming up very soon, can I ask what do you think would happen if it were not possible to agree a comprehensive list of minimum core obligations? What would be the result of that?
Ali,
I have to start with that one. I mean, it's about looking at what you're asking for. The level, the minimum, universal minimum core. It's not about agreeing a set. They exist. So there is already an agreed list of minimum core obligations, which is we will leave you with for the next level. If you're wanting to have that more relative measure in relation to minimum core to achieve a life of dignity. There's a couple of points. I mean, first is the idea again that Louis mentioned earlier about that, but not having to be a consensus. So we're not looking towards a kind of citizens assembly type consensus where you vote on, you know, it's not that kind of process. It's not an election. So secondly, I think it will not be effective if it's done correctly. While ensuring that we have this baseline, this universal approach, there's already that comprehensive set. Well, it might not be completely comprehensive, but there is a set of minimum obligations that have already been agreed by the committee, and we are already subject to them. The issue about not reaching consensus won't actually be a thing. What has to be clear is that if the baseline is to be the universal standard, then this is what we have, and we are incorporating international standards as they already are. So I think it's that it's the next stage. It's about what level above that universal minimum, but we are already meant to be complying with this.
Is there anybody else wanting to come in there from the panel?
Rob, do you want to?
No.
Louis.
Well, I could say. Give you a wee bit of the background of one of the reasons why we suggested this through the process of the task force, and it's to do with when you see the practice. So if you use examples, I've mentioned some examples like Germany, Belgium, Switzerland, Colombia, Brazil, where they have this process, where their minimum core obligations are justiciable, that has been through mostly judicial interpretation. Right. So you might have some countries like Germany that it's constitution, it's basic law. The interpretation of the constitutional court has gone into what is called existential minimum. And that has led to then define on a case-by-case basis what it is. You have countries like Belgium that have actually enacted law, for example, in the 70s, that recognize what is called minimex or minimum de moyens de existence. So Colombia, minimo vital, recognized by the Constitutional Court. So you have these things that have come from a lot of like judicial interpretation, and that has to do with independent body from government and parliament holding people's rights to account. Now, we wanted to make sure that that process was sufficiently well done and a list that is that allows sufficient guidance, which is why the consensus, the wording of consensus can be tricky, right? So we want to make sure that the absolute rights of those most vulnerable are guaranteed, that they're held to account, but it doesn't necessarily mean that people should sort of negotiate their rights and negotiate their basic entitlements. It means that we have to be able to listen carefully to wide considerations from lived experience, technical experts, policymakers, parliamentarians, government, and then need to be able to provide a list that ensures a sort of absolute minimum of guarantees, even if some people disagree and even if some people find it not necessarily very satisfactory. And that might be because it might imply prioritizing some more marginalized groups before the wider population.
Thanks. Fulton, back to you.
Thanks very much. Yep. Oh, thanks, convener. Thanks very much for those helpful answers, panel. Well, you'd referred to a few times referred to the red lines of minimum core obligations. Can you those and duty bearers if these red lines are indeed crossed? And again, thinking about that in the context of the incorporation and the bill being passed.
Fulton, you broke up a little bit there. I don't know, Ali, Louise, have you got the question or do you want Fulton to repeat it?
I think we got it.
Okay.
What happens if red lines are crossed in relation to compliance of minimum core, right? Okay, so I think I've mentioned to some degree with Pam's question, and I would divide it between the structural nature, so versus the individual case. So there is a need of what happens if there are determinations of, let's say, a duty bearer not meeting their minimum core, but we find that information through, for example, indicators, data. So we come up and see there is 15% of people in X local authority which are homeless and do not have access to basic shelter. And that should potentially trigger, for example, if that information is met through regular reporting, regular monitoring or an inquiry, that could trigger different impacts into sort of binding recommendations. You need to do this, X, Y, and Z. Or sort of general non-binding recommendations, scrutiny from NHRIs or the committee, etc. But that is if you have sort of wider, you're not able to identify a victim, right? You just know that there's 15% of the population in X area. That's from the systemic nature. And then there's the individual nature. So what happens when it's an individual or a group of individuals who are directly alleging that something is happening to them and that thing that is happening to them violates their basic rights under minimum core obligation. And then that should trigger either through a non-judicial route to remedy. So, for example, a lot to explore about the role of the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman, for example, about the type of determinations that through a complaint handling mechanism that could entail. And then the final stage, again, which will be a judicial review. So what can the court do and what can the court determine of non-compliance of minimum core? What type of excuses can the public authority provide? So we've talked about the impossibility case, for example. And then final point for that, Fulton, is what I've mentioned in the past about really thinking carefully of how, to what degree our current routes and routes to judicial and non-judicial remedy are really accessible, affordable, timely, and effective. So if there's going to be real sort of justiciability, we need to really sort of reflect on the big issues about access to justice currently in Scotland for human rights breaches.
Can I just add to that? I think the goal of introducing this new legislation, or incorporating the legislation, is it's not about this resulting in court at the first opportunity. This is a last resort. We don't want to suddenly have a massive influx of cases. When we're talking about meeting a minimum core, if we've got a massive influx of cases, we've got a real problem, because we shouldn't be this because of the level that it is. So it is about looking at what the needs of the country are through that lens and addressing that through your budgetary generation, allocation and spend. And this is the backstop when things go wrong. So it's just to sort of, I know that there when the new introduction of legislation, that there's a fear that it will suddenly result in this massive wash of, you know, court cases. But that's not, that shouldn't be the case.
Thanks. Do you have anything else you want to ask?
No, I'm okay, Convener. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Fulton. Rachel, do you have any final questions?
The last... question I was going to ask was really about the comparisons with other countries and where the minimum core obligation system is working. And obviously the Netherlands has been mentioned, but their health system is quite different to ours. I wondered if you could give us an overview of how it really is working in reality. Anyone?
Luis, do you want to?
Sure. To divide in the sense that what we are proposing for Scotland doesn't really have a comparator, in the sense that the process would be a quite world-leading arrangement, in the sense that we don't have a country that has had a process of really defining them. It's what I personally call a legislative approach to minimum core. So it's, you know, holding people's view into account and then bringing to Parliament to have a final legislation that plays into that. What we have is wide concepts. So wide concepts provided in constitutions, legislation, judicial interpretation, and then on a case-by-case basis, does this meet this, does this not meet this? So, for example, you have, and they might be composed of different values within the constitution. So Colombia is a really interesting example, because Colombia, the interpretation of what is called mínimo vital, so vital minimum, is from three values of the constitution: the value of the welfare state, the value of human dignity, and the value of solidarity. And so you might have courts saying this forms part of the vital minimum, and that at times can be about solidarity, dignity and solidarity. So yes, this is a difficult thing to do, and this requires a lot of resources, but this is essential if our constitution requires a country of solidarity, and we need to put those in place. So again, you have good examples of how you do on a case-by-case basis, but it requires a lot of judicial intervention, and that is normal in countries with a civil law jurisdiction in which the role of the court is quite prominent and there's a wider sort of legal acceptance that is for the court to do. We thought from our perspective that the sort of mixed legal system in Scotland and the sort of nature of how the courts operate, it wasn't necessarily fit for purpose in the same way that the sort of similarities of Germany, Belgium, Colombia, Argentina weren't really similar in the way that we thought. And therefore, we are using some of those examples of the value of human dignity, the value of minimum essential levels, the way that the committee has developed it, but making something quite unique.
And sorry to interrupt, but how would a minimum core obligation work to increase some people who have lower health and education and life expectations? The minimum core obligation would be universal, and therefore those people who have better life expectations or better health outcomes will be getting the same commitment as those who lived in, from poorer backgrounds. So how does that work?
So that's a great question. an absolute fantastic question, because it fits into something that we've been quite concerned about, if I may, the risk of maybe being too obsessed about minimum core obligations. And as I said at the beginning in the introductory remarks, we have to see minimum core as part of one of four obligations. You have to be progressively realized rights based on your maximum available resources, ensure that non-retrogression is or non-retrogression happens, and all of that while meeting your minimum core obligations. So the example you've just done that is really important touches on the real importance of progressive realization, right? And one of those of how we understand progressive realization to take concrete, deliberate, targeted steps. One of those is, how do you prioritize those most marginalized, vulnerable, to take concrete, targeted steps to progress their rights? So there are two things that are happening at the same time. You're meeting the minimum core, that is, for everyone, basic minimum core, but you're also having to ensure that you're progressing and realizing the rights and of everyone, but particularly looking at those most marginalized and most vulnerable. So there's a risk of only looking at this out with progressive realization and then thinking, this is it, this is ESC rights, this is what the bill will do, this is what the process will do. And it's not just about that. There's other really relevant areas, because if you don't have progressive realization, you have what we sometimes call a minimum ceiling. And it's minimum core is a minimum flooring, right? What do you do beyond that is particularly relevant. And how do you prioritize those most marginalized in those targeted steps is also really relevant.
Well, it would be interesting to find out how that works in the Netherlands, you know, in terms of narrowing the equality gap, I suppose, through their private and public contribution to the health system. But that's maybe for another day. I wanted to ask Rob, in the last session, you said that an MCO should withstand the changes in leadership or in government, and we should take the politics out of this. How does that work in practice, particularly with the current pressures on the political climate and, you know, the global pressures that we're currently facing?
Yeah, I guess it comes back to that, how we set up the participatory process, and then out of that, how do we get an outcome that has legitimacy and meaning for Scotland that can withstand the test of time? I'd probably defer to what these guys were saying earlier about that process and about how, you know, you don't need to reach consensus and then have a vote. It's not a citizens' assembly type thing. Yeah, if you can get that right, then it kind of takes away the politics from it. And bear in mind that what we're talking about here is a minimum that you would imagine any government should, like, it would be very difficult for any government to challenge once it's been established, but I imagine politically. And I think there's a wider point here, because I think we're coming towards the end, is that there's a lot of work maybe that needs to be done on defining minimum core here in Scotland, how we measure that, making sure that duty bearers and rights holders understand their obligations and their rights. But there's a danger that all of that work is kind of seen as the end goal and like an aspiration, but we need to remember what we're talking about is, yeah, it's not an aspiration, it's an immediate minimum.
Okay, thanks. Alison, did you want to add anything to my original question?
What I was going to say has gone completely out of my head.
It was about the international comparisons, really, and then, of course, Louis was talking there about the retrogression and the equality between different groups.
It's still gone
society.
Completely out of my head.
It doesn't matter.
I had a good point as well. I think, I mean, in terms of, I think it was around the politics, is, you know, the UK and Scotland through the UK signed up to a variety of treaties and covenants. These obligations exist irrespective of who's in power. And the minimum core is that basic level, as Rob said, that it doesn't matter who's in power, that these are the minimum levels that every country, including ours, has already signed up to. So I think, I know that certain aspects when you look at what human rights, when you're talking about rights and delivering rights, is connected to political. We need to take it away from the political agendas to be able to look at what minimum core is, what progressive realisation we are looking to achieve, and that these aren't part of a political process.
Okay.
Or shouldn't be.
Thank you. Thank all three of you for coming along this morning and giving us your thoughts and views. I can pretty much guarantee that it won't be the last time you speak to us on this, but I think it's really, really important, your last point, Rob, there, that all this work we are doing is not an end in itself. It is for us to establish so that we can ensure we are actually doing all the other things, the other three commitments that Louise has talked about a couple of times today. So thank you for coming in. Really appreciate your contributions. And we will suspend briefly before we move on to our private session. Actually, no, we will end the public meeting now, won't we? And move into private. Thank you very much.